Indiana Jones has a tendency to get into trouble over and over and over and over again. One of the best movie scenes ever filmed was the beginning of Raiders of the Lost Ark, where Indiana retrieves a golden idol in a temple full of booby traps. That scene raises a number of questions. The start of Indy's troubles begins when he doesn't guess correctly the weight of the idol. Before he enters the temple, how did he know to fill a bag full of sand? Did he have an idea of the size and shape of the idol beforehand? Was the bag too heavy or too light? How could Indiana have more accurately measured the correct weight of the idol? If you have any ideas, put them in the comments below. This is Chemistry Pitch, and in this video, we are going to pitch to you why chemistry, and more specifically, significant figures, could have helped Indiana Jones. If you like our videos, don't forget to subscribe. Before we can try to answer the questions about the idol in the Chachapoyan temple, we need to talk about some chemistry. Science, and in particular, chemistry, is concerned about Indiana's dilemma. How accurate and precise can we measure quantities like mass, volume, or temperature? Accuracy and precision is important for an organization like NASA when they're trying to traverse millions of miles through space and make a precise landing on Mars, or when they need a space vessel to make a docking with the International Space Station. Accuracy and precision is important for millions of citizens when companies like Pfizer or AstraZeneca make important medications. Measurement, precision, accuracy. These are all essential to chemistry. Lord Kelvin, after whom the temperature unit Kelvin was named, dramatized their importance when he said, "If you cannot measure it, it is not science." In everyday language, there may be little difference between precision and accuracy, but in chemistry, we make a distinction between them. This is the first of two ways in which chemistry could have helped Indiana Jones. He constantly is getting into fights, brawls, and gunfights. More time at the shooting range could have helped Indiana. The shooting range is a great analogy for how precision and accuracy is different for chemistry. Precision has to do with how consistent your measurements are with one another. For Indiana, in the shooting range, that would mean a nice grouping of shots regardless of whether it is on target or not. Accuracy has to do with how close a measurement is to the true value. For Indiana, that would mean getting his shots right on the bullseye. Indiana's goal would be to get so good with his revolver that he can shoot with both precision and accuracy. It is possible for him to consistently shoot off target in the same area. That's precise, but not accurate. It could even be possible to be so bad at shooting to be both inaccurate and imprecise. But that wouldn't be Indiana. That would be more like a stormtrooper. Okay. Natives shooting at Indiana? Neither accurate nor precise. Bad guys in the market? Well, they do seem to be pretty consistent in hitting each other, so let's label this one as precise, but not accurate. Knocking down baskets looking for Miriam? Precise, but not accurate. Nazi punching Indiana? Accurate and precise. If a scientist were to measure an object three times and got a mass of 32.18 grams, 32.21 grams, and 32.17 grams, in one respect, that group of measurements would be considered good because they are precise, because they are consistent with each other. Notice, it is normal for the numbers to be slightly different from one another. That is due to random errors of human measurement or from the particular conditions the instrument was experiencing. Factors like vibrations in the ground, air movements, air pressure, and other factors can affect the measurement. If, however, the true value of the mass were, say, 33.47 grams, then the scientist's measurements would be not considered accurate. Some kind of systematic error affected his measurements that consistently altered his data. But how important is this all really? Lord Kelvin stated it well. Accurate and minute measurement seems to the non-scientific imagination a less lofty and dignified work than looking for something new. But nearly all the grandest discoveries of science have been but the rewards of accurate measurement and patient, long-continued labor in the minute sifting of numerical results. Okay, let's get back to Indiana Jones and the Golden Idol. Remember how he incorrectly guessed the weight of the idol? Unfortunately, Indiana didn't realize that humans are notoriously bad at noticing differences in weights, and his being able to simply guess the correct weight is pretty unlikely. How could chemistry have improved his chances? Here are some thoughts. You notice before he enters, he fills a bag with sand. Why would he do that? Could it be that Indiana did research ahead of time and actually knew quite a bit about the booby traps he was going to encounter at the temple? For him to have at least a close guess of how much sand to add to the bag tells us he had a good idea of how big the golden idol was going to be. It seems Indiana knew much about the 2,000-year-old temple and its idol. He even had a floor plan of the temple. If he knew the dimensions of the idol from his research, could he have calculated the exact weight of the idol ahead of time? If this hypothesis intrigues you, hit the like button below. Could it be Jones, acclaimed professor of archaeology, expert on the occult, an obtainer of rare antiquities, didn't have the expertise to make these calculations that a professor of chemistry would be able to do? Assuming Indiana knew the composition of the idol, most likely pure gold, he would know the density of the material, and would simply need the volume of the idol in order to calculate its exact mass. Surely, in 1936, Indiana could have had the scientific instruments needed to make these measurements. Here's where chemistry and significant figures can help Professor Jones. An important principle for chemistry is this: calculations can only be as precise as your measurements. But how do chemists keep track of precision during calculations? While some scientists use some advanced ways of tracking error, the most common way in introductory chemistry is to use significant digits, also known as significant figures. To oversimplify the idol's volume, let's say Indiana was able to calculate it using the volume of a cube equation: volume equals length times width times height. And let's say one of the ancient manuscripts he found had the idol measuring 8.57 centimeters in width, 6.15 centimeters in length, and 14.1 centimeters in height. The precision of those measurements can be said to have three significant digits each. When he multiplies the three numbers together, he would get a volume of 743.1476 cubic centimeters, according to his calculator. The problem is, calculators don't know anything about precision.
Always being generous.
Sorry, Indiana, but do our measurements warrant precision down to 0.0001 or 1/10,000th of a cubic centimeter? No, they do not. If the precision of our original measurements had three significant figures, then our calculation should also have three significant figures. Calculations can only be as precise as your measurements. Anyone can learn how to use significant figures. There are some basic rules you could learn, but to give you a sense of how significant figures work, let me give you some examples. The length of a staff, 204 centimeters. That would be three significant figures. The mass of Reggie the Snake, 10.9 kilograms, would be three significant figures as well. The mass of a date, 9.000 grams, would be four significant figures. The mass of a bazooka, 10.00 kilograms, would be four significant figures. Mass of a boulder, 21,000 kilograms, would be two significant figures. Volume of the Ark of the Covenant would be 851,000 cubic centimeters, and that would be three significant figures. Mass of a poison dart, 0.000162 kilograms, which would be three significant figures. Mass of a piece of chalk, 0.00321 kilograms, which would be three significant figures. Notice that sometimes zeros are not significant, and sometimes they are significant. If you study them closely, there's a system and pattern in how zeros work. Can you figure out the pattern? But what about the idol? What could have been the mass of the idol? Using the hypothetical volume you calculated of the idol and the density of pure gold being 19.32 grams per centimeter cubed, a calculator would give us a mass of 14,357.610666 grams. But do our original measurements warrant that precise of a number? Since our volume only had three significant digits, our calculated mass can only have three significant digits as well. So we round our calculation to 14,400 grams so that it will have three sig figs. Remember, calculations can only be as precise as your measurements. As a side note, if the idol weighed 14,400 grams, or 14.4 kilograms, which is roughly 32 pounds, I doubt Harrison Ford's stage prop was actually pure gold based on how easily he tosses it around. Measurement, precision, accuracy. These are all essential to chemistry and future scientific discoveries. Enrico Fermi, architect of the nuclear age, once said, "There are two possible outcomes. If the result confirms the hypothesis, then you've made a measurement. If the result is contrary to the hypothesis, then you've made a discovery."